Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Cape Fear Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are here with us today. If you haven't already done so, please take the red fellowship pads, which are parked in the pew rack on the center aisle. Sean, hold that up. It looks like that. If you would add your name and the date to that page as it goes down the row. If there are people seated. It's early, y'all. It's early. If there are other people on the pew with you, then pass it down to them, and as it comes to you, you can add all that information. If the date is not there when you get it, please put that on there as well. And then if you'll pass it back to the center aisle, one of our deacons will collect that at the conclusion of the service. Let me tell you a few things that are going on in the life of the church. I will direct your attention to the announcement section of the bulletin. You can just take that out. That's the section we'll be talking about right now. I'm just going to highlight a few things that are going on in the life of the church. This morning, we welcome Miss Paulette Fittshur. She's from Samaritan's Purse, and she'll be speaking in a few moments about Operation Christmas Child. So we look forward to that. Glad to have you with us, Paulette. Officer Nominating Committee will meet after worship today, right after the conclusion of the service. Next Sunday will be our Presbyterian Women's Thank Offering Potluck Lunch. That will take place immediately following worship. Bring your favorite dish to share. Get out those old recipes or some new ones that you want to try. Bring those dishes for our potluck next week. And there is information in the bulletin about the thank offering, but we've got some posters and stuff around, so you can always check those. I want to thank those who participated in the Trunk or Treat last week. We had a lot of fun. The weather was absolutely ideal. We had cars. We had a lot of kids from the community. So thank you very much for those of you who participated in that. This week we had a Gangbusters Young at Heart Halloween party. I've never seen so many costumes. Fantastic costumes, to the point where you would not recognize the folks in this congregation. Really wonderful. Some photos are on the Young at Heart bulletin board. That's in Jennings Hall. If you're in one of those pictures, you're welcome to take that photo, but you can also just kind of peruse those as you go next door. There really are some wonderful costumes in it, and the party was an awful lot of fun. Other announcements. We'll be collecting our sensibility banks next Sunday. This is for the Presbyterian Hunger Program. So if you've got those banks at home, bring those with you. We'll collect those at the start of the service next week. Also, our November-December newsletter is available in print. There are some at the table across from the secretary's office. They're also available online. So download it or grab a copy. There's a lot in this issue. There's a lot going on in the life of the church in November and December, as you can imagine. So we don't want you to miss out on anything. So grab a copy of this on your way out today. I believe those are all the announcements that I have. Are there others? Yeah, Pam.
Circle number 3 meets Wednesday morning at 10:30.
Okay. Circle number 3 will be meeting this Wednesday at 10:30. I assume circle number 2 is meeting Tuesday at 10:30. Circle number 1 is meeting at Monday at 6:30. Do I hear circle number 4? Do we have a circle number 4? How about a circle number 5? Anyone willing to start a circle number 5? It's a group. It's a gathering of women. Yes. Another question? Okay. Our Presbyterian women, that is a good question, Sean, because we kind of, sometimes we speak in lingo. It is one of our Presbyterian women groups. We have 3 of them. So, small groups, circles, there you go. Anything else? Paulette.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I know some of you have already said you've packed your Operation Christmas Shell's shoeboxes, and some are probably still working on them. And I'm here to give you a little more information about the ministry and also maybe inspire you to pack one more. Do we have the, I can't see the slides.
The logo.
Okay, so yeah. The banner that you see right now is just sharing that Operation Christmas Child is an international outreach ministry of Samaritan's Purse. I know a lot of people here being in the home state of Samaritan's Purse is familiar with it. I'll just go over it in case you're not familiar with it. It's an international Christian relief and evangelism organization headed by Franklin Graham, Billy Graham's eldest son. Samaritan's Purse works in more than 100 countries to provide spiritual and physical aid to victims of war, poverty, natural disaster, disease, and persecution. And they're right now in our home, in our neighbor state of South Carolina, helping people with the flood victims. Operation Christmas Child does three things. We invite, collect, and distribute. Basically, when you think about it, we invite, collect, and distribute. So we invite people, groups, churches, businesses, individuals, families to pack gift-filled shoeboxes. We collect them once a year in November. So I think the date for your church is November 15th to have your boxes in. And we collect them throughout the United States just for 8 days, just November 16th through the 23rd. And then we deliver them to needy children all over the world in over 100 countries every year. That is a huge undertaking, wouldn't you agree? 100 countries every single year. Today, in Operation Christmas Child started, so many people here in North Carolina say, oh, we've been doing that forever. Well, not really, because Operation Christmas Child started in 1993. So this is its 23rd year. Any guess how many shoeboxes have been collected and distributed in that 22 years history? Any guess? What was it? Oh, I wish. 124 million. That's huge. That's huge. In a 22-year history, 124 million children have been touched by Operation Christmas Child. We'll get into that a little bit more. These children that are receiving the shoeboxes, they live in desperate situations. They suffer from extreme poverty, famine, disease, war, terrorism, persecution. Operation Christmas Child is the largest children's evangelism project in the history of the world. And you have a chance to be able to be part of that. Pretty exciting, don't you think? I'm going to share Operation Christmas Child mission statement. A lot of people have never seen this, and I think it's very powerful to look at. And I'm going to invite a little audience participation here, and let's read it together, shall we? To demonstrate God's love in a tangible way to needy children around the world, and together with the local church worldwide to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Does that put a little spin and right aspect on why you're packing shoeboxes? Why children? Why are we targeting children? First, there's a very powerful statistic that one in three children that hear the gospel accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. One in three. Had anyone ever heard that stat before? Powerful. Children's ministry is very powerful. Second, children have a hard time keeping a secret. Agree? So if they've just heard about the good news and they go home, what are they going to do? They're going to share it. So there's a huge impact, ripple effect of your shoebox gift. Have you ever thought of that before? Why a gift? Well, who doesn't like getting a gift? Many of the children that receive an Operation Christmas Child shoebox have never received a gift ever in their life. If you've never received a gift before in your life, how are you going to accept the free gift of salvation? So we help them realize that they can get something for free. Make sense? And also, there's the unlimited potential of the ripple effect that one shoebox can make in their families when they go home and share this news and the gift, in their neighbors and their friends. So I'm going to ask you one question. What is this? It's a shoebox, but what really is it? I'm going to share a little Operation Christmas Child lingo with you, okay? We call it a go box. What do you think go, G-O, stands for? But, time's up. What? Up, no, but I like that. I like that effort. It's a gospel opportunity. Have you ever thought of your shoebox gifts as a gospel opportunity? Because each and every single one is a key for opening the gospel to that child and that family. Anyone that packs the Operation Christmas Child shoebox is an international missionary. Ever think of that? Here is the list of the 17 countries where the Wilmington area shoeboxes went to last year. In other words, if you packed an Operation Christmas Child shoebox last year, you were an international missionary to any one of those 17 countries, and you didn't even have to leave home. Powerful. Are you starting to look at shoeboxes a little differently? In Wilmington, the area totals that we collected, and the Wilmington area comprises of six counties. In 2014, we collected 34,094 shoeboxes. That's not just 34,094 shoeboxes. That's 34,094 children and their families and neighbors and friends that we reached. Every single shoebox represents a child. Remember that. What's the most important thing to include in your shoebox? Guesses? That is something, but I'm looking for something that you can't see. Close? Oh, that's a good one. I like that. That is true, but I'm looking for something else. I'm looking for prayer. Everyone that came in should have received one of these bookmarks. And on the back side, it's actually a daily prayer for a different aspect of Operation Christmas Child. I invite you to get those out, please. And I'd like to read today's prayer, if we could. And I'm going to try to do this without my glasses. Everyone have it out? For Sunday, we're going to thank the Lord for working through Samaritan's Purse to distribute more than 124 million Operation Christmas Child shoebox gifts since 1993. Pray that millions more children will experience God's love and hear the good news of Jesus Christ as they receive these simple gifts. I ask you, I invite you to tuck this into your Bible, into your daily devotions, and please pray for Operation Christmas Child. And more specifically, pray for the child who's going to be receiving your shoebox gift. Our awesome God already knows the child that's going to be receiving your shoebox gift. And let's just aid his good works in praying for that child to open up their hearts and their minds to hearing about the good news when they receive their shoebox gift. So how does a shoebox gift become a gospel opportunity or a go box? A little real quick, what goes beyond the box, and this is another half an hour talk, but in just a short time, when they receive their shoebox gift, they receive their box, And they also receive with their box this booklet. It's called The Greatest Gift of All. This booklet is 32 pages. It's the gospel in 32 pages, basically. It's beautifully illustrated. It's brand new. Most of these kids do not have a brand new book or any books. They get to take this home. And guess what? Who else is reading it? Parents, siblings. Then, beyond the box, one more step, all the children that receive a shoebox gift are invited to a 12-week discipleship program. 12-week discipleship program. I should be hearing a lot of woo-hoos and amens to that. Isn't that amazing? Did you know this about the Operation Christmas Child? This is huge. When they complete this 12-week discipleship program, they have a graduation ceremony. This is big in the underdeveloped countries. And they receive a New Testament in their native language. All these materials are in their native language. And they get to take this home and share the good news. These shoebox gift recipients that go through the greatest journey become little disciples. In Jesus' closing words in Matthew, what did he say? Go and make disciples of all the nations. By packing a shoebox for Operation Christmas Child, you are fulfilling that great commission that we're all called to. I hope I inspired someone to pack one more shoebox. Question? That's a great question. I can answer more questions afterwards, but I'll answer that one. It's a big process, and churches in all these other countries, they actually go through an application process with Samaritan's Purse. And there's volunteers on that in every single country, and they teach them how to teach the greatest journey and so on. But it's an application process because they want to make sure that they're going to follow through with all the boxes. Mm-hmm. That's a great question. So these shoeboxes become incredible tools to resource these poor churches in underdeveloped parts of the world and further his kingdom. They plant churches. They do incredible things. Honduras Boy, a few years ago, Samaritan's Purse extended an invitation for me to go to Honduras and pass out shoeboxes. This is a Honduran boy. I don't even know his name. I don't know how old he was. I don't know the dynamics of everyone that's in the picture. Would I snap this picture right after a shoebox distribution? And what he did was absolutely spurred by our awesome God, because God knew it was going to touch my heart the way it has. And this happened several years ago, and you can see how emotional I still get over my Honduran boy. And that's all I can talk to him. I don't know his name. But what he did right after I snapped this picture, and they're very timid. They're very, very timid when you go to other countries. They're very timid with Americans or any foreigners. And but he walked right up to me. He left the comfort of his family. He walked right up to me. Right up to me. Still smiling, that gorgeous smile, looking directly in my eyes. Shoebox is still up on his head. And with his free hand, he waved and he said, "God bless you," in English. I have no idea how he knew that. I couldn't even ask him any questions. I was just so moved, and they were yelling for me to get back on the bus. So I got back on the bus, and but he was amazing. And I just ask you, as you're packing your shoeboxes, even if you've already packed your shoeboxes, pray over your shoeboxes, and just imagine the child that's going to be getting your shoeboxes walking up to you with that beautiful smile, looking directly in your eyes, shoeboxes still on their head, waving and saying, "God bless you." Because trust me, they would if they could. They would if they could. Closing key points. What goes into a shoebox is fun, but what comes out is eternal. That's Operation Christmas Child's latest motto, and I just love it, and I married it with this great picture. Each and every shoebox, Operation Christmas Child shoebox gifts, is a missionary tool that opens the door for the gospel. And one shoebox equals one child, equals one life, and equals one salvation. I hope I inspired you about Operation Christmas Child. If you've already packed your shoeboxes, maybe pack one more. If you haven't already packed them and you're thinking of a number, up it by one more because it's one more child. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Paulette. She's going to stick around after worship. She'll be over at this table. So if you've got questions or she can answer all kinds of questions. So thank you very much, Paulette. Please stand as you are able and let us worship God. Was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying,
"Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb."
Today our voices join this ongoing heavenly hymn of praise. In Jesus' name, let us worship God. Christ calls us to share the heavenly banquet of his love with all the saints in earth and heaven. Knowing our unworthiness and sin, let us ask from him both mercy and forgiveness. Let us pray together the prayer found in your bulletin. Eternal God, in every age you have raised up men and women to live and die in faith. We confess that we are indifferent to your will. You call us to proclaim your name, but we are silent. You call us to do what is just, but we remain idle. You call us to live faithfully, but we are afraid. In your mercy, forgive us. Give us courage to follow in your way, that joined with those from ages past who have served you with faith, hope, and love, we may inherit the kingdom you promised in Jesus Christ. Amen. The good news. We do not live to ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again so that he might be Lord of both the living and the dead. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, we too might walk in the newness of life. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. The teaching of Christ, a new command I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Turn to those around you and greet one another with signs and words of peace. Getting settled, I'd like to invite the children to come forward and meet me at the chancel steps. Hello. Have a seat. Yeah, you're welcome. Come on up. Good morning, everyone. We're going to talk about promises today. People make promises every day, right? Sometimes we give something to another person as a sign of our promise. Sometimes we sign a name, our name, to seal our promise. Other times we just give our word to another person that we will do something. I'm sure you've all seen a ring like this. It's a wedding ring, right? When a man and a woman get married, they usually make promises to one another. They say something like, I promise to love you for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, as long as we both shall live. Then they exchange rings. They give each other rings as a sign of that promise. This is a postcard that we asked some folks to send back to the church, fill it out and send it back to us. So this is an ordinary postcard. It came back to us in the mail this week. Of course, on a postcard or even a letter, you've got the person that it's going to right there. What is up in this corner? A stamp. Yeah, what does a stamp do? Yeah, and it's kind of we pay for stamps. Stamps cost X amount of cents, and so we need that to send a piece of mail. But the stamp is actually something else. The stamp is a promise. When the postal service sells us this stamp, and you put it on a postcard, you stand it on a letter. It represents their promise to deliver it to whom the envelope or the postcard is addressed. It doesn't matter if it's cloudy or sunny, if it's raining or snowing, hot or cold, the mail gets delivered. That is the promise that this stamp represents. Now, you all are too young to have one of these. What is this? A credit card. That's credit or debit card. That's correct. One day you probably will have something like this. Most adults have a credit card, which they use to buy things. When you buy something, you sign your name on a slip of paper afterwards. When you sign that paper, you are promising that you will pay for the items that you purchased using this card. So in that case, your signature is a promise. People make promises every day. Do they always keep their promises? Not always. Unfortunately, some people don't. God makes promises too. The Bible is full of God's promises. Does God always keep God's promises? Yes. The answer is yes. God always keeps God's promises. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is one that says, for no matter how many promises God has made, they are always yes in Christ. This morning, I want you to always try and keep your promises. It's not easy. Sometimes it's not possible. But remember, God isn't like you or me. God keeps his promises. When God says he loves you, that is a promise and that is a guarantee from God. Let's pray. Dear God in heaven, thank you for your faithfulness in keeping your promises. Help us to be faithful in keeping our promises to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls.
To his hand we bow.
A word of thanks to Janice for filling in for Nancy. Janice, we are so glad to have you with us. Built-in substitute. Our first lesson this morning comes from Psalm 24, which can be found in the Bible on the page numbers listed in your bulletin. We will read this responsively, which means I'll read the odd-numbered verses, and I invite you to respond with the even-numbered verses. Before we do that, let us pray. Holy God, may your word read and proclaimed be for us this day living water and the bread of life. We yield ourselves to the word you will speak to each of us, seeking only to hear your voice, see your face, and respond to your will for our lives. Amen. Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it.
For he has founded it on the seas and established it on the rivers.
Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place?
Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully.
They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation.
Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory.
Our second lesson is from the book of Revelation. It can be found in the Bible on the page numbers listed in your bulletin. I invite you to read along or follow along as I read it this morning. Chapter 21, verses 1 through 6a. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." Friends, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's face it, becoming jaded in this day and age is pretty easy. How often have we had the thought, "Now I've seen everything"? The problem is, as soon as you begin thinking like this, something is bound to come along to change your mind. There is something new happening in the world all the time, whether we see it or not. A recent example occurring in the Bighorn Mountains of Wyoming happens to be one that you can see. It's called a large gash or a crack, and it's a geological anomaly that has people puzzled. Go ahead and Google it when you get home. It's quite impressive. It measures up to 750 yards long and 50 yards wide. One engineer believes a small spring of water caused the bottom to slide out and shifted 15 to 20 million yards of earth. No matter the cause, this type of event both amazes and startles. We're not used to such things. Oh, sure, the Grand Canyon was similarly formed by water from a river, but that process took 6 million years, and no one was there to get a before photo. Here's the thing. Just because we think we've seen it all before doesn't mean we have. God is always creating, either directly or through the natural forces that our Creator has put into place. And this morning's text from the book of Revelation is a reminder that God is still on the throne. And it, more importantly, it affirms that God is in the process of making all things new. Much has been written about, studied, and misconstrued when it comes to this book. And while I am certainly no expert, there are a few things to keep in mind as they pertain to our discussion this morning. For instance, it is the only so-called apocalyptic book in the Bible, and a good working definition for apocalypse is the unveiling of something hidden. In terms of literary style, it is in the form of a letter written by a man self-identified as John. However, he was most likely not the author of the gospel by the same name, but a Christian prophet nonetheless. Just as the book of Genesis is meant to help us understand our origins in the broadest of terms, so the book of Revelation is intended to help us understand our destination. And in both cases, the answer is the same: God. Poet T.S. Eliot once wrote, "In my end is my beginning." For believers like us, the assurance is that we come from God and that God will be with us at the end. That to be absent from the body is to be present with God. Revelation 21 comes very near the end of this letter, a letter in which John has been told to write down what has been revealed to him, what he sees in a vision, and then to send this letter to the seven churches in the Roman province of Asia. John's vision is a wild one, filled with images of scrolls and creatures, horses of different colors and trumpets, beasts of the land and the sea, dragons, and lakes of fire. And while many people have tried to read the tea leaves, try to figure out what all these events, what all these symbols mean, trying to match these events from Revelation with worldly happenings, Revelation is not a doomsday prophecy. Instead, it is a vision of what God intends for his creation. God redeems. God transforms. God renews. God restores. This is what God has always done, and the activity that the Lord will continue to carry on. John tells it this way: "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. The earth is being transformed. Chaotic waters, tears, death, mourning, crying have all disappeared. God is not making all new things. Instead, he is making all things new. Once again, salvation will come through Christ, referred to in John's vision as the Lamb who died and is alive again and has the power to overcome evil. It's worth noting that in the concluding verses of Revelation, John ends with a prayer. Come, Lord Jesus. Our text this morning holds special meaning for us on this All Saints Day. Traditionally observed the day after All Hallows Eve, otherwise known as Halloween, it is a day in which the saints who have gone before us are remembered. This passage is significant because these words bring comfort, hope, and reassurance, and are often recited in the context of a memorial. No matter the pain and suffering of death, one's infirmities do not follow the individual into eternal life. Instead, they are redeemed and restored. They receive the newness of life. They are made whole again. And for the loved ones left behind to grieve, these verses assure us that God is present, wiping the tears from our eyes. Today, we not only honor the saints who have gone before us, whose examples we wish to follow, but also the saints who are alive today and the saints who will come after us. According to the Bible, the word saint refers to any believer, living or dead, who is in Christ, in whom Christ dwells. In other words, saints are ordinary Christians, like you and me. In her new best-selling book, Accidental Saints, Pastor Nadia Boltz Weber writes, "It has been my experience that what makes us the saints of God is not our ability to be saintly, but God's ability to work through sinners. The title saint is always conferred, never earned. As the good Saint Paul put it, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Pastor Weber continues, "I have come to realize that all the saints I have known have been accidental ones, people who inadvertently stumble into redemption like they were looking for something else at the time, people who have just a wee bit of a drinking problem and manage to get sober and help others to do the same, people who are as kind as they are hostile." End quote. By virtue of our baptism in Christ, we are saints, and we belong to the communion of saints, this grand procession of believers, past, present, and future. In our text from Revelation, John writes that the words he was given by God are trustworthy and true. This is the good news that permeates all of Scripture, that God does what he promises. God promises hope, power to the weak, and strength to the powerless. Salvation through Christ, grace, peace, never-failing love, and eternal life. And these promises are for you. The newness of God is for you. Jesus told his followers that receiving God's promises was simple. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. In observance of All Saints' Day, I will, in a moment, name the members of this congregation who have died since last All Saints' Day, and who now rest in God's eternal peace. Also included in this prayer will be an opportunity for you to offer names of the saints living or dead who have encouraged you along the way of faith in Christ. Let us pray. Eternal and almighty God, we give you thanks for all your faithful people, the saints who have followed your will in a grand procession of praise throughout the world and down through the centuries into our own time and place. We hear their stories in the pages of Scripture, in the records of history, in the recollections of our families, and in our own childhood memories. As we remember these people, inspire us by your Spirit to join their ranks and follow our Lord through life, to be bold as they were and brave as well, witnessing to your righteous truth and generous love. Give us grace, O God, that we will leave a legacy of faithfulness to encourage and challenge those who follow us along the way of discipleship. God of all saints, today we especially remember the saints from among this community who have departed our company over this past year. We thank you for their faithful witness, for their courage amidst strife, and their hope in the face of death. We remember Bob Sellers. Cynthia Wallace. Ed Van Nordheim. Dorothy Cunningham. Betty Boggs. We remember so many other saints who have walked this road with us, whom we name before you, aloud or in silence. Mom and Dad.
Betty Goff.
Continue to inspire us by their faithful witness, that we too might join in bringing your justice, mercy, and peace to our world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. Folks will come from east and west and from north and south. All the citizens of God's rule in Christ will feast forever in glory. This is the Lord's table, his dinner party spread across time. And all who are baptized in him are invited to this foretaste of the age to come. With thanksgiving, let us offer God our grateful praise by singing "Let Us Break Bread Together," number 513 in your hymnals. Please be seated. May God be with you.
And also with you.
Beloved of God, lift up your hearts.
We open them to the one who knows us and who loves us.
Children of God, give thanks to the one who is our hope.
Our praise will always be offered to our love, our trust, our God.
We pray. It is always right and good to praise God, who created us and never stops loving us. God has such great love for us that we can call ourselves the children of God, and indeed, that is what we are. We are God's children. God sent Jesus to share our life and journey with us, to show us how to live as God wants. Through reading the Bible, prayer, acts of justice and kindness, and this holy meal, we seek to be more like Jesus each day. We are followers of Jesus. With words and actions, Jesus taught us that the ways of God are sometimes different from the ways of the world. We are called to love God with our hearts, souls and minds, and our neighbors as ourselves. When we do these things, we are holy. We are saints. We give thanks for the many people who have gone before us, and are with us even now. A great cloud of witnesses who have tried to live God's love every day. And with their lives have shown us how to be followers of Jesus. We are part of the communion of saints. Jesus invited saints and sinners to dine with him and be his friends. And Jesus invites us to this sacred meal in which we can taste and see, experience and remember the goodness of our God. Until Christ comes in final victory and we feast together with all the saints at God's great family reunion, keep your church one in service to the world here and now, even as we pray for the world you so love, silently or aloud. Speak your peace in the world, O God, where wars rage and violence triumphs. We lift before you our prayer for the health of all nations, that all people may flourish, for all people in positions of power over others' lives. May your will be done. May your kingdom come. We pray for those who grieve. For those who are sick. For those struggling to live the fullness of your resurrection. Send forth comfort as only you can give. We thank you for your generosity to us in all time and in all places. We thank you for your many blessings. And out of your generosity and blessings, we give to the work of your church. We pray that you would use our tithes and our pledges to further your kingdom here on earth. We pray these and all things in the name of Christ who lived, who died, who rose, and who reigns in power, hosting this and every feast. And we pray as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, our Savior took a cup. After pouring it out, he said, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes. The gifts of God for the people of God. We will be serving communion this morning by intinction, the dipping of bread into the cup. The elders and I will serve each other first, and then we will serve the choir, and then we will invite you to come down two rows down the center aisle of the sanctuary to the two stations that will be on either side, and then you're welcome to return to your pews by the side aisles. If you are unable to come forward and would like to receive the sacrament, please indicate that to us when we are finished serving everyone else, and we will bring it to you. Would those elders who are serving please come join me? friends, this is the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. The body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Did not receive the sacrament that would like to. After this, I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palm branches in their hands, crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb." Amen. One of the ways in which we thank God for the blessings that God has given to us is through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Would the ushers please come forward? Most holy and gracious God, we do give you thanks for these gifts and the givers, and we dedicate them to your use, both here in this community and around the world. Amen. Friends, our worship ends, and now our work begins. May the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, and the ever-present fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.